Welcome back. Glad you could join us. In episode 4, Jack discovered he was the Chosen One. Chosen by King Wurmalade to risk life and limb in order to save the monkey's kingdom for him. It seems being the town idiot helped you become the Chosen One to do stupid things. Now, episode 5 finds a flabbergasted Amberjack before King Wurmalade and his court as he learns exactly what the scheming monkey has in mind for him.
Tell me, what do you want? Money? Women? We don't have either of those to offer you. But if you say self-respect and maybe a little coin on the side, well, have I got a deal for you.
With that, the scrawny monkey in the waistcoat and no pants somersaulted from his throne, bounced off a post, and landed on Amberjack's shoulder. The chin strap attached to his battered crown kept the circlet of office firmly on his head, despite the rapid maneuvers.
How'd you like to be your own man,
I am my own man.
Wrong.
Wurmalade poked Jack's nose as he said it.
You're Earwicker Town's man, bought and paid for. You're the town idiot, remember?
It's an honest living.
Amberjack said, abashed, twiddling a loose button on his tunic.
Aye, it's honest. And more than a little degrading,
King Wurmalade said with an arched brow.
Oh, well, that's rich coming from a jumped-up organ grinder's monkey. Traded in your tin cup for that fancy crown, eh?
Jack shot back, pinging a thick nail against a golden point. What nerve, he thought. Wurmalade leapt backwards in a furry somersault, landing on the cushion he had just left. He crossed his arms and tapped his hand foot impatiently.
A funny man. Point is this. You do this thing for us.
Risk my life to kill a wild boar thrice my size.
And his bully boys.
The king said, forestalling Trumall's reminder with a sharp gesture. Wurmalade tapped the side of his flat nose with a long, skinny finger and winked.
How will you get me back my self-respect, assuming it has been lost?
Amberjack said warily. At that, Wurmalade rolled his beady eyes dramatically.
Actually, how am I supposed to kill, what is it, a dozen wild boars? I'm one man.
Amberjack leaned forward and looked Wurmalade in his black little eyes.
One old, tired, overweight man.
The king didn't answer him straight away. He gave the man a sly smile, then a sidelong look, and wagged his long tail slowly, languidly even.
You're a man,
he said simply, as if that was all the answer Jack needed.
You'll figure a way. It's what men do, isn't it? Kill things? Your kind do it so well, I can't believe you have any doubts that you're the right man for this job.
He took the tip of his tail in a hand and began grooming the tufted end deliberately, like plucking the petals from a daisy. A flurry of soft monkey sounds came from his thin lips. The king knew he had the old man testing his bait, tasting it to see if it was wholesome and fine to eat. Wurmalade could see in his mind the cork bobber dancing on the water's surface, only just submerging in full before popping back up.
You're a man,
he repeated. Time to set the hook. Wurmalade smiled and deliberately looked around the old barn.
This place would make a wonderful theater,
he said, dropping his tail and throwing his long arms wide to encompass the cavernous barn.
A little paint, some tidying up, a few bales of hay for seats, the manure picked up and carted off, strings of paper lanterns hanging from the rafters, and there you are. the new home of Amberjack's mystifying menagerie. Ready for its opening night performance.
Wurmalade looked at the old man critically, taking in the worn, saggy flesh, the heavy belly, the pale, watery eyes. The eyes had a spark of interest in them. Amberjack looked to the rafters, to the loft, and finally to the creatures that surrounded him, each one preternaturally still and silent. It was so queer, it was unsettling. Underneath the jowls and wrinkles and beer belly, though, King Wurmalade saw more than just the town idiot. Mother Nature! He hoped the man was more than he appeared. He said in a low tone that quickly built up excitement.
You're a showman. I'm a showman. Between the two of us and the rest of my court, we have these unwashed yokels tossing copper and even silver at our hand feet by the double fistful. Word would spread of the wonders of Amberjack's mystifying menagerie from village to village. And town to town, throughout the wild wood.
And why would these rubes throw anything but rotten tomatoes at our hand feet?
Jack asked.
When they can see all the common barnyard animals they can stomach simply by turning around? I believe most of these folks sleep with their pigs and chickens under the same roof. And I hold court by the town fountain daily, sun up to sunset. This barn feels too closed in.
Oh.
Wurmalade lamented somewhat theatrically, Jack mused. Well, the wee monkey did say he was a showman.
You cut me, Jack. You cut me deep. The creatures of my kingdom are no mere barnyard animals. Pietro, my chamberlain, is a daredevil on the wing. I've seen him swoop through the loft doors as if old Fetch himself were after him, flare his wings at the last before alighting as matter-of-factly as you please on the highest brace above us at a practically horizontal attitude. All in the dark, mind.
Yes, right. If it was done all in the dark, as you say, how did you see him? Himself being a patch of old Fetch's black cloak torn free. I could barely see him now if he stood still. Where are you? Where'd you go? See?
My kind are nocturnal,
Wurmalade said flatly.
Oh!
Jimmy Limestone's pipe.
That means they do most of their business at night, so it would be fair to say that King Wurmalade here can see in the dark as well as you or I can at noon.
I know what nocturnal means,
Jack said just as flatly.
I may be an idiot, but I'm not stupid.
Getting back to the subject at hand,
King Wurmalade cut in.
I'll grant you that no one would pay half a penny to see a bird do what birds do.
I'd pay half a penny to see a bird do a doo-doo on you-know-who.
Chuckled Trumhall to the laughter of those around him. The monkey leaned forward on his cushion as a sly look appeared on his pale face.
Let a snow mouse cling to Pietro's back as he performs daring deeds of danger and delight. Shooting through flaming hoops as if the mouse were steering him. Well, who wouldn't pay to see that?
I'd give you Trumhall's mother to see that.
Someone shouted from the hay to widespread chuckles. Amberjack said nothing. But the thoughtful look that suddenly appeared on, then evaporated from his face, spoke more loudly than any words Wurmalade could ask to hear. The man was close, but he was not the king's man yet. Just a little more persuasion.
Fusco Bomarito can read your fortune at the bottom of a teacup.
Again?
The goat blurted in surprise.
Oh, sim-sim is a thing we do in my village.
Trumhal,
Wurmalade continued.
Sturdy honey badger, Trumhal can eat fire while walking a tightrope over rusty farming tools. Zella, our faithful hound, can juggle hedgehogs. The brothers Sitwell, Slaughter, and Sluggle. And don't forget the most wonderful and miraculous thing of all. We can all.
Wurmalade paused for dramatic effect. He could see every face, every snout, beak, muzzle, and snoot inch forward in anticipation.
Speak.
The gleam suddenly sparkled in the old man's eye once more, but this time it didn't fade. It blazed like the sun. There was no mistaking it. Greed. Wurmalade knew greed, knew what it looked and smelled like in others. Wurmalade cultivated his own greed, fed it, nurtured it, then used it to build his tidy little kingdom like no mere monkey, no mere animal could.
Think of the coin jingling in your purse. No more degrading yourself for a capper here and a capper there. And talking about silver pennies tingling hand over fist into the collection jar. Instead of acting the fool out there.
He indicated the world at large beyond the weathered planks and cobwebby beams that surrounded them.
You could be in here, warm, dry, counting your money while my subjects and I do all the dancing and capering. Why, we could even perform as ventriloquist and his dummy. I'll sing something while you stand there with nervous tics on your face. Everyone will think you're throwing your voice.
Hey, I could do amazing feats of strength,
chimed in Fusco Bomarito from a dark stall, warming to the idea.
As I tell your fortune.
Soon the shaggy pony and the ram and his ewe threw in ideas for novelty acts they could perform. In a burst of impromptu inspiration, the ducks and chickens put forth an idea for a daredevil flying act they decided to call Barnstorming Birds, boasting that they could outfly Pietro on any given day. Why, even Jimmy Limestone suggested he could pair up with King Wurmalade for a knife-throwing routine. Jimmy insisted on a blindfold for himself, however. Eventually, so many ideas came gushing from the minds of the very creative group of barnyard animals that King Wurmalade called Pietro to him to commit to memory all the suggestions they had come up with. They'd sort through the details later and discard the more outlandish ones. Jimmy's knife-throwing act was immediately rejected, owing to the fact that King Wurmalade had no knife-throwing skills to speak of. Amberjack stood amazed at the flow of ideas coming from the animals. There was something here, something that could be very profitable indeed. Never in his dreams did he imagine such a thing as animals who not only could communicate with men, but who had quite complex ideas and who could plan cunningly. He instantly felt both guilty and nauseous at the thought of being such a lusty meat eater all his long life. He'd never be able to look at a pork chop in the face again, not after making Jimmy Limestone's acquaintance.
Yep. I'm your man. Yeah, uh-huh.
What else could he say? It was brilliant.
Billow, Tucker,
called Wurmalade. He snapped his fingers, keeping a small smile on his face and his keen eyes on the old man. Amberjack stared into those beady eyes and saw cunning and became uneasy. The dark eyes looked too mannish coming from the